Okay, class, welcome back. Today we're going to talk about intermolecular forces and how they hold matter together. If I could summarize our objective down into one sentence, I would say that our objective for today is that we would be able to explain the relationship between the chemical structure of molecules and the relative strength of their intermolecular forces. In saying that, let's dive into what we have today. The strength of intermolecular forces between molecules or atoms are the forces that determine the state of matter a substance is at a given temperature. Moderately strong to strong intermolecular forces tend to result in substances in the liquid or solid state, while weak intermolecular forces tend to result in substances in the gas state. If you have not made the connection already, these intermolecular forces are what determine the properties of melting and boiling point. So these forces are most definitely important in chemistry, but what exactly are they? Intermolecular forces are forces that originate from the interactions between charged, partially charged, and temporarily charged portions of molecules or atoms. Basically, these are the forces that hold individual atoms or molecules to one another, which consequently usually deals with the charges and Coulomb's law. According to Coulomb's law, the potential energy of two oppositely charged particles decreases or becomes more negative as the distance between the particles decreases. So, as a proton and electron are attracted to each other, the distance between them decreases, thus decreasing the potential energy between them. Molecules with partial or temporary charges are also attracted to each other because their potential energy decreases as they become closer together. Despite these facts, we must realize that intermolecular forces, despite the distance from each other, are significantly weaker than bonding forces. The reason for this deals with the relative distance and size of the charge. For example, if I have two water molecules interacting with each other, the bond length between the hydrogen and the oxygen on one molecule may be around 96 picometers, while the distance between the hydrogen atom of one molecule and the oxygen atom of another molecule may be 300 picometers. So the force between these two molecules would be considered intermolecular forces. These forces are spread significantly farther apart than the bonding forces holding the hydrogen and oxygen together in the same molecule. For the rest of the video, we are going to spend our time talking about these forces, intermolecular forces that hold molecules together, and what makes them strong or weak. Okay, so our first one is London dispersion forces. London dispersion forces are forces present between all molecules or atoms. These forces are a result of a fluctuation of electron distribution within a molecule or atom. Since all atoms have electrons present within them, this force is present within every molecule. The electrons in an atom or molecule may, at any one instant, be unevenly distributed throughout the atom or molecule, thus creating a polar molecule or atom. This temporary dipole may only last an instant, but it is enough to create a weak attractive force. The magnitude of these electron displacement can also influence the strength of the dipole and consequently the strength of the dispersion force. So because of this, it is reasonable to think that an atom with a larger electron cloud has more electrons in which it can hold, thus having a higher probability of electrons being displaced. This means that the larger molecules have a higher probability of having stronger dispersion forces. If we look at the boiling points of two molecules, n-pentane and neopentane, we realize size is not the only factor affecting dispersion forces. Both these molecules have molar mass of 72.15 grams per mole, but the boiling point for n-pentane is 36.1 degrees Celsius, while neopentane is only 9.5 degrees Celsius. In other words, the intermolecular dispersion forces holding n-pentane molecules to each other are significantly stronger than those holding neopentane together. The reasoning for this difference in strength of forces is dependent on the magnitude of overlapping forces. Because n-pentane orients itself in a linear fashion, it is easier for intermolecular dispersion forces to overlap one another. interweaving these forces creates a strong force, holding the molecules to one another, opposed to Infinitane's spherical shape. Our next intermolecular force that we're going to talk about is dipole-dipole forces. Dipole-dipole forces occur only when a permanent dipole is formed in a polar molecule. The positive end of one dipole will be attracted to the negative end of another dipole. Remember, all molecules have dispersion forces, so by adding polarity into the mix, we are adding more forces to interweave to hold these molecules to each other. Because of this, it would be reasonable to assume that polar molecules have a higher boiling point than nonpolar molecules because the polar molecules have dipole-dipole interactions and London dispersion forces holding them together, while the nonpolar molecules have just dispersion forces holding them together. To illustrate this, let's talk about formaldehyde, or CH2O, and ethane, C2H6, and compare their boiling points. Both these molecules have a molar mass close to 30 grams per mole. When comparing the boiling points, though, we see that formaldehyde has a boiling point of negative 19.5 degrees Celsius, while ethane has a boiling point of negative 88 degrees Celsius. If we map out the polarity of each bond within the methane molecule, we would see that they would cancel each other out, thus making methane a nonpolar molecule. On the other hand, if we map out the polarity and electronegativity of each bond on the formaldehyde, we notice that formaldehyde molecule is definitely a polar molecule. So, if I have a solution of formaldehyde, the molecules would orient themselves so that the poles would interact with each other, thus creating stronger intermolecular forces and accounting for the higher boiling point. The polarity of liquid molecules can also play a huge role in the miscibility, or the ability for two liquids to mix or separate from each other. Generally, polar liquids are miscible with other polar liquids, but not miscible with nonpolar liquids. This is why water, which is a polar liquid, is not miscible in pentane, which is a nonpolar liquid. Similarly, this is why when we combine water and oil, we see two different distinct layers of liquids, and this is because oil is a nonpolar molecule while our water is a polar molecule, whether that be vegetable oil, olive oil, or motor oil. Polar molecules containing hydrogen atoms bound directly to a small electronegative atom such as fluorine, oxygen, or nitrogen exhibit intermolecular forces that we call hydrogen bonding. We can think of the hydrogen bonds as souped-up dipole-dipole forces. This is due to the fact that there are large discrepancies in the electronegativity or electron pool between the hydrogen atom, which is extremely small, and the electronegativity of nitrogen, fluorine, or oxygen, whichever one it's combined with, which are usually extremely electronegative. This difference in electronegativity creates a stronger dipole-dipole force. It is worth noting that though we call this hydrogen bonding, it is not the chemical bond that holds the molecule together. Instead, it is the force that holds one molecule close to another. To continue with our boiling point illustration, let's take ethanol and dimethyl ether. Both these compounds have a chemical formula of C2H6O, and they have a molar mass around 46 grams per mole. The boiling point for ethanol is 78.3 degrees Celsius, while dimethyl ether is negative 22 degrees Celsius. We attribute this change in boiling point on the orientation of the molecule. We can see how both the molecules orient themselves in the picture below. If we look at the ethanol, we see that the hydrogen molecule is bound to the oxygen, which creates a highly polar bond. If we have a solution of ethanol, these polar molecules will orient themselves so that their charges complement one another, which creates strong intermolecular forces. So this hydrogen binding to an oxygen in ethanol makes the molecule extremely polar, thus increases the intermolecular forces between the molecules. Remember, this is just another layer added onto our intermolecular forces that are holding molecules to one another. Our last type of intermolecular force is ion-dipole forces. These forces occur when an ionic compound is mixed with a polar compound. What happens here is that your ionic compound would dissociate into its respective charges or respective ions. Then the polar molecules will surround the ions with the oppositely charged poles. So if I'm mixing sodium chloride in water, the sodium chloride would dissociate into sodium plus ions and chlorine minus ions, and the water molecules will orient themselves so that their oppositely charged poles are close to the respective ions. So the positive pole of the water molecules are going to be close to the chlorine anion, and the negative poles will surround the sodium cation. Out of all the types of intermolecular forces, the ion-dipole forces are the strongest and most complicated. So that's all I have for you when it comes to intermolecular forces. Remember, these forces are not chemical bonds, but instead are supplementary forces that hold molecules to one another. I hope this video helped you out, and keep up the good work in this classroom. See ya.